than God does. We look on the poor in terms of what they can become. Maybe if you work hard, maybe if you do something right, you, poor person, can become like me. That's a sad commentary, but I think sometimes it dwells in all of us. But God sees the poor so much differently. God looks on the poor, and He sees them the way they are. And do you know what He sees, friends? He sees people that are His children. They're not rich. They're not poor. They're His children. And that's what He sees. So what does that mean? What does it mean that poor Mary was chosen to be blessed among all the women in the world? What does it mean that when God sent His Son into the world, He sent Him to live not with the nobility, but He sent Him to live with the poor folks? It means this. You read the gospel and you ask, who is it who would be elevated? Who is it who would be overjoyed and exalted by hearing the announcement? The answer is those of low estate. The poor, the have-nots, those who are the outcasts, not a part of the in-group in this life. It's the poor, certainly, who would hear it. And they were the first to hear it, probably because there were so many of them. Statistics, figures tell us today that 80 to 90% of the people back in those days were considered to be poor. And the fact is, there was never climbing the ladder. They would always, always be poor. And then there were others who were also considered outcasts, those who were ritually unclean, those who led lives that were frowned upon by the upper crust. The outcasts were some foreigners. They were the enemies. They were the sinners. Those were the people that respectable folks had nothing to do with. And what does Jesus say? What does God say? It's those folks who He will lift up. It's those folks who will be exalted. So when Mary sings, "My soul doth magnify the Lord, for He has regarded the low estate of His handmaiden," it means that the status she had in society was what was being lifted up. When she sings, "Thou hast knocked the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of low degree," it means that from here on, we must regard the outcasts, those who are different, those who are poor, those who are not like we are. We must, as Christians, consider them our brothers, our sisters. We're one. And He's the Father of all of us. Luke goes way, way, way out of his way to tell us this. He tells us where Mary was born. He tells us she was of low estate. He contrasts her with Elizabeth, somebody who was way different in social ranking. And then, where does he put Mary? He confines her to a stable. Think about the dude running the inn. Think about that innkeeper. When Mary and Joseph came in, and the thoughts that probably went through his head, and he probably thought, they can go out in the stable. That's the kind of people they are. They're probably more comfortable out there with the animals. And then Luke has the shepherds come to the stable. Luke doesn't have the kings or the wise men. Matthew does. Matthew has the kings and wise men come and visit Jesus because Jesus is royalty. But Luke says that the shepherds came to visit shepherds. Now folks, it got no lower in Jesus' time than shepherds. Shepherds were poor. Shepherds were humble. Most of them were teenagers. Most of them were wild boys that lived on the periphery on the edge, on the margin of society. What does this mean? Well, it means that at Christmas, at this time of the year and every day of the year, God declared that every one of us, every one of us, sitting here and around the world, is precious, and that we should be treated that way. Everyone in God's sight is precious, no matter what our status is in this world, no matter how we compare to others in society, no matter who we are. Folks, you're precious. We're precious. God looks at each one of us and says, Mitch, I value you. Bridget, I value you. Randy, I value you. To each one of us, he looks you in the eye. And he said, you are important, and I love you. When the angel came to Mary, Mary must have said to herself, gosh, I matter. I really, really matter. I know now that I am an irreplaceable individual. Now, you know, at first, they only anointed kings and queens. They just anointed royalty. But then after Mary, after the church was founded and began to baptize people, they anointed ordinary people when they were baptized. Sometimes they anointed it and put oil on their forehead. Sometimes that anointing just meant the laying on of hands. And they started baptizing and anointing babies as those little children began their journey through life. And what that said to the parents of those children and to those babies is that you are precious. You are irreplaceable. And whether you were baptized when you were an infant or whether you made a conscious decision to be baptized when you went under the water or the water was sprinkled on you, that's God's anointing. And that's God saying to you, I love you as much as anything in the world. You are precious. You have value. And nothing, nothing, nothing can take that value away. And then they started anointing folks that were dying, those who were at the end of this life, and they were getting ready to embark on another journey. And that anointing at the end of life says to those, you are irreplaceable. You matter. You matter. We matter. In the eyes of God. That's what it means, this visitation that we've talked about. It's an anointing. Blessed are you among all of the women in the world. Those words were Elizabeth's to Mary. Blessed are you among all of mankind. Those are the words that God speaks to each one of us. He speaks them through the Christ child there in the manger. Blessed are you among all of the people of the world. You're important. You're blessed. You're irreplaceable. You are an anointed son. You are an anointed daughter of God. You, my friends, are God's children. What a gift. Ponder it. Merry Christmas.